والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. إن شاء الله بإذن الله. Continue with the talk about أركان الإيمان, the pillars of Iman, and there are the six pillars of Iman: to believe in Allah and the angels and the books and the messengers and the last day and the qadr, خيره وشره. And of course, we started with the most important of all the pillars, the pillar that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and the earth for that pillar, that is al-Iman billah, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if we try to give this pillar its rights and to explain it, not from our own words, but from what the Quran says and what the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that will take years and years. It's basically the tafsir of the whole entire Quran, because the Quran is the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the Quran is all about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is one of the things that we can do individually, which is you would make one khatma of the Quran, you recite the Quran from the beginning to the end with one focus, that in your heart you try to get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To the best of one's ability, you're not talking about to know the rulings and every single details of things, but the clear verses of the Quran that talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and what are the calls that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling mankind and the believers. Messages from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for sure that ashraf, dhikr wal-ilm, the most honorable remembrance and knowledge, is the one that talks about the most honorable and the most important madhkur and ma'loom. The most important to be remembered is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the most important thing in our life to get to know is to get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's nothing more important and better than this, which is the joy of this life and hereafter, is to get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the only way we get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is by the wahy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the revelation from Allah, that is the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And if you let me, inshallah ta'ala, today we'll have it the last time we'll talk about the first pillar, although there are so many subjects in it. And next time, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives life, we'll talk about the Iman bil Malaika, the second pillar. But the point here that I wanted to mention with the first pillar of Islam, al-Iman billah, is to point out this fact that we need to read the Quran to get to know who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with his names and attributes, and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from the human beings, and so on. Because to have all the different aspects of an Iman billah is that we need to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Rabb, is the Lord of the Alameen, is the creator, the sustainer, the provider, as we mentioned last time, and the owner of all things, and life and death is in his control subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the owner of all things. And as a result of that, which is the way of the Quran, then he is the only one that deserves to be worshipped alone, and to worship him alone subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that would bring the subject of al-ibadah and the worship, and what negates that, which is the shirk and associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is basically what the Quran is about. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has the perfect names and attributes, to believe in them. Nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's the Al-Hir and the Al-Sir. We believe in everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated about himself, without saying any similarities between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his creation, without denying them, without distorting them, and saying nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's the Al-Hir and the Al-Sir. But if we look into the some of the verses of the Quran, to just get a reminder, that should affect our whole entire life. If we get this first pillar of al-Iman strong, then we won't have any deficiencies by the will of Allah when it comes to understanding the matters of the deen and how to be steadfast on the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because usually when a person is falling into a sin and persistently doing that, that's pointing to some disease in the heart that has to do with the lack of knowledge about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The heart is attached to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're not talking about the sin that happens once in a while and a person repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately. Everybody is falling into this, nobody is sinless. But the one when he would choose to deviate from the truth and to continue to be like this, that means there's a deficiency somewhere. And that's why it's because of the weakness of the Tawheed and the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And briefly, inshaAllah ta'ala, tonight, related to this first pillar of Al-Iman, I would like to remind myself and everyone with the best ayah in the Qur'an, which is Ayat Alkursi, which we all say it many times every day, and we know its meaning very well. But if we say it every day, many times, that by itself should be sufficient that our whole entire life will be according to the way of the Prophet ﷺ. Knowing the meaning of it is one thing, but having the heart to be moved, right, with the ayah and with the Qur'an, this is another thing. This is the level that we need to achieve, where the Qur'an moves our hearts, make our hearts purified from the sins. And this is what the Qur'an does, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned. The Qur'an, giving the example of it, like the rain, when it comes and makes the valleys flood and it takes away the dirt, the same thing the Qur'an, what goes into the heart and clean all the weaknesses and the deficiencies and the doubts and so on. And the best ayah in the Qur'an is Ayat Al-Kursi, by the statement of the Prophet ﷺ, as the hadith in Sahih Muslim and others. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he asked Uwayy ibn Ka'b radiyallahu anhu about what is the best ayah in the Quran, so immediately he replied by saying Ayat Al-Kursi. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, "Liyahnika al-ilm aba al-munthir," which means "Hani'an lak al-ilm." That means great is the ilm that you have, O aba al-munthir, the kunya of Uwayy ibn Ka'b, that he had this great knowledge, that he knew the best ayah in the Quran. And the best ayah in the Qur'an, the whole ayah, is about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing else, from the beginning to the end of the ayah. Although you would find at the end of Surah Al-Hashr few verses that talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also in the beginning of Surah Al-Hadid, verses that talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but this is one ayah, right? This is one ayah that only talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's why it's the best ayah that gives the miraculous meanings and the meanings that we are in need of it in every second of our life. And that's why it's from the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ to recite Ayat al-Kursi after each salah. And the hadith is hasan, it's sound. When the Prophet ﷺ said, there are two hadith and they're both sound by the will of Allah, they say, one of them, whoever recites Ayat al-Kursi after each salah, فَهُوَ فِي ذِمَّةِ اللَّهِ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ بَعْدَهَا. That means he's under the protection of Allah till the next salah. And then the next salah, the same thing. So who would not want to be under the protection of Allah? And also the other hadith, that whoever recite Ayat al-Kursi after each salah, لَمْ يَمْنَعْهُ مِنْ دُخُولِ الْجَنَّةِ إِلَّا أَنْ يَمُوتِ. That means nothing will prevent him from entering Jannah except death. Death is the only barrier between him and entering Jannah. And this is also a sound hadith, although some of the ulama, they talked about its sanad, but it's a sound hadith as many of the ulama authenticated it. So this is great virtue, and we say before we sleep, and hadith of Al-Qurayla, I won't mention the hadith when the shaitan was coming to take from the sadaqah, and he told him at the end of the thing between him and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said that this is the means for protection for him throughout the night till the morning, because the shaitan, he can never sustain to hear Ayat al-Kursi. This is means of protection from the shayateen, from the devils, and so on. So it's definitely, it is being said, but we need to make the hearts move by Ayat al-Kursi. So briefly, the ayah starts with the best name ever. Starts with Allah. Allahu la ilaha illahu al-hayyul qayyum. And you see from the first word, not la ilaha illallah, Allahu la ilaha illallah, al-hayyul qayyum, and the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala above the jalalati Allah, where it has, once you say it, as the ulama they say, you already have said all the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Has all the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by just saying it. And the debate among the people of knowledge, does it have a root to it or not? Right? And those who have said that it has a root to it, which is the more authentic opinion, comes from ilahatan, which means comes from ibadah, the ma'bud, the one to be worshipped. And this is what Ibn Abbas, the nephew of the Prophet wasallam, clearly he said in the ayah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about Fir'aun, the people of Fir'aun, they said to him about Musa alayhi salam, وَيَذَرَكَ وَأَلِهَتَكَ, that he would leave you and your aliha. Aliha is the plural of ilah, which is means the ones that you worship. But in another recitation, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said, وَيَذَرَكَ وَإِلَهَتَكَ, وَيَذَرَكَ وَإِلَهَتَكَ. إِلَهَتَكَ means your worship. He would not follow your worship, the idols and so on. So it means the one to be worshipped, which gives the meaning of La ilaha illallah. That means the only one worthy of worship, right, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So once a person says Allah, then he gets all the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says La ilaha illallah, the only one worthy of worship, and that's the dhikr that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say. He did not used to say alayhi salatu wasalam, Allahu, Allah, 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 like this. Right? This is innovation. The Prophet ﷺ never said that. Neither the companions of the Allah, neither the Khulafa al-Rashidin. Right? The dhikr that the Prophet ﷺ would say is La ilaha illallah. And La ilaha illallah, what's more perfect, that you should say أفضل ما قلت. He said that alayhi salatu wasalam, أفضل ما قلت أنا والنبيون من قبلي. The best thing I said to me and the Prophets before me is La ilaha illallah. وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير. This is the most perfect, and this is what a Muslim should try the best to say, and this is something that we're supposed to say 100 times in the morning and 100 times in the evening. We have work to do, there's jobs to be done. That's why the ulama, they call it wazifa. Wazifa means what? Job. This is a job that the person has to take. So it's a beautiful job, something that doesn't take much, but the person should do it with the great virtue of it. And again, if we talk about it, we won't be able to finish the ayah. Ayat Alkursi is basically 10 sentences, 10 short sentences. The first one, Allahu la ilaha illa hu. Illa hu al-hayyul qayyum. So the first one, Allahu la ilaha illa hu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no one worthy of worship except Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the word that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us for. Created the heavens and the earth and the jinn and the everybody. It's created for this, to fulfill this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one worthy of worship. And the Quran is very clear. Every messenger was sent. What the Quran message is saying, the messenger was not debating with the people about the existence of Allah and philosophy. No, he was just calling them to La ilaha illallah, and that's it. To worship none but the creator of the heavens and the earth. Because as we heard before, they believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the necessity of every human. This is by necessity that you don't need to be convinced. It's in the innate of the human beings. Right? But it's the arrogance and the stubbornness, it's all kinds of things that makes a person deviated, but it's in by necessity, it's in the hearts of every human being. So the messengers, they call people to La ilaha illallah. That's the most important thing. Allahu la ilaha illahu al-hayyu al-qayyum. Al-hayyu al-qayyum. And there are some hadith, and some of them are authentic, like the hadith in Sunan al-Tirmidhi, which is the most authentic of all these hadith, that talks about these two names being al-ism al-a'zam to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The most al-a'zam, the greatest name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that if a person asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by these names, Allah will accept his dua. And there are many statements from the ulama, over 10 or even more, what is the best name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or al-ism al-a'zam, that if a person would use it in his dua, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would accept his dua. Many said al-hayyu al-qayyum, many said, some said al-hayyu only, but al-hayyu al-qayyum, because there is some hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that mentions this. Plus, it's in the most virtuous ayah in the Quran. Al-hayyu is the ever-living. And the meaning of al-hayyu is not just refers to life Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his life is not given by something else, right? He's the one that bestows life on everything. And he subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most rich. Because the human beings, their life is given to them by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they die after they live on earth, and then they would be resurrected, and they would live an everlasting life after this life, either in Jannah or in Hellfire. But who's the one that is giving them this life? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we say ever living, human beings will be ever living after their death. Right? And the soul basically doesn't die. The soul turns from this life to the barzakh till the day of judgment. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-hayy, with the alif and lam, gives that significance. That means he is al-hayy. Everybody else is given life from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-hayy. And that's why this name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, as many of the ulama, they said, all the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes, you can talk about them from the name al-hayy. Because he's the ever-living. And then all the different acts of worship and relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of that. وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ. Rely on the hayy, the one that never dies. Al-qayyum, from qama yaqum. Allah Azza wa Jalla, qama, when you're standing, right? But of course al-qayyum here means that, refers to the af'al of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Refers to the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that everything, its life and its provisions and everything about it is sustained by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one in charge and maintaining his whole creation. Right? This is Al-Qayyum. So all the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes under the name Al-Qayyum. Right? So Al-Hayy Al-Qayyum, basically, when you say Al-Hayy Al-Qayyum, when you say Al-Hayy Al-Qayyum, Al-Hayy refers to all the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Al-Qayyum refers to all the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That has all of these names and attributes in saying Al-Hayy Al-Qayyum. And if he is Al-Hayyul Qayyum subhanahu wa ta'ala, then who are these human beings that are turning away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and being arrogantly disputing the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That when a person understands these meanings, the heart is moved with this, then we will see what our position in this life. And that is to fulfill the ubudiyya in its pure sense. The more we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more we have this al-iftiqar ila Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, to be in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not that we choose to have this, this is by necessity also. Right? And it just needs for the person to ponder, to reflect, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us that ability. So, and the lub al-ubudiyyah, the core of the ubudiyyah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-iftiqar ila Allah. To feel that you are nothing, that you are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you turn to him subhanahu wa ta'ala because he's al-hayyul qayyum. Otherwise, once a person thinks of himself and he suggests and he thinks and he likes and all of these types of things, right, weakens this iftiqar or to be in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Till the Muslim will reach the level that no matter what happens, he's always witnessing the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is keeping him busy all the time instead of blaming this person and blaming that person and all of these things. He's witnessing the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we, something that we should always mention, that whatever happens to us, it's happened by the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to witness the action of Allah. Even if someone comes and hits you, for example, right? You have your right, you can take your right, no problem, this is something else, I'm not talking about this. But the heart is working, that you're witnessing that this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permit for it to happen, and this is by the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us to ponder over this because of our sins, to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to elevate ourselves, a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not to immediately think, oh, this is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to elevate my level. MashaAllah. Right? No, we are sinners. Right? And when something happens, we have to look into ourselves like this, to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to seek forgiveness from Allah and so on. So Allah la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum. Once he said that, this is great virtues, of course, if the heart is pondering and reflecting these meanings. And every sentence The one after it, it's related or connected to the one before it. So Allah la ilaha illa hu, he's the only one worthy of worship because he is al hayy al qayyum. Other than al hayy al qayyum, they are not to be worshipped, they're not to be attached for the hearts and so on. Then the third statement, la ta'khudhu sinatu wa la nawm. La ta'khudhu means does not take him sinna wa la nawm. As-sinna, as Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said, is awwal nu'as, the beginning of the sleep, which is dozing off, the first level of that you sleep, right? This is the sinna. And now is being sleep out. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, does not take him sinna or no, none of them. لَا تَخُذُوا سِنَةٌ وَلَا نَوْمٌ. The sinna is the first level of being asleep. If that does not, as it's the ayah says, لَا تَخُذُوا سِنَةٌ, that means this does not take Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he does not have this because he's free from deficiencies. That means the nawm is, of course, if that's the case, then there's no nawm whatsoever. So why the nawm is even mentioned? Right? If the ayah says, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows slumber or rule, losing off will overpower Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that means مبابي أولا, I don't know how to say مبابي أولا, that means therefore there is no sleep, but the sleep is mentioned. Right? The sleep is mentioned still, and this is from the example of mentioning al-khas wa ba'dahu al-'am, the specific and then the general, to make the matter so clear. Plus, a person might sleep without dozing off. Right? A human being, if you're extremely tired, right, sometimes you just fall asleep. Right? You don't doze first and then you sleep. So to deny any means whatsoever of anything except the perfect names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He is Al-Hayyul Qayyum. Right? And the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the heavens and the earth, that we don't know much of it, and it's so huge that when we think about it and when we see what people have went into what and see what of the earth compared to the other planets and all of these things. And as the Prophet ﷺ said, as it will be mentioned when we talk about the Kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Al-Kursi related to Al-Arsh, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is like halaqa fi ardin thalam, is like a ring in a desert, right? And it's another hadith, every heaven from the seven heavens related to the one after it is like a ring in a desert. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the, nothing is the like of Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all of this is maintained now and yesterday and all times forever by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not like those who believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this creation, He left it. Wal'iyadhu billah. Right? So you witness now the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where it just be alive. The fact that there is air now, this is now maintained by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the fact that you are still alive and the soul is not out of our body. Everything around us, everything, it's just that this is enough ayat from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the Muslim to be always in remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم. له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض. له means to him. ما في السماوات وما في الأرض. What's in the heavens and what's in the earth. And as many verses in the Quran with the taqdeem wa ta'khir, the sentence you can say it in the other way around, linguistically, other than the Quran. But the Quran, anything, if you move a letter from its place, you won't have the same meaning or the powerful meaning that is mentioned in the Quran. Lahu, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that gives al-hasr, the exclusiveness, that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ma fi samawati wa ma fi al-ard. ما refers to غير العقل, right? من refers to the human beings, or العقل, the one that has intellect. ما usually they say refers to غير العقل. No, ما refers to غير العقل, and العقل and its own general, and refers to everything. Everything physically and also linguistically refers to the physical creation of Allah and الأحوال. الأحوال means the situations of people, the state of things, right? That it's not physical. So, لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ did not leave anything. everything in the heavens and in the earth to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The ownership, right? The absolute ownership, everything is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you see the sequence from one sentence to the other and the implications of this, that we don't have this absolute ownership. We only have ownership versus to one another, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the rights of the human being. But in reality, everything is owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So our time, our effort, our health, our life is owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So He's the one that would order, and we listen and we obey. We have nothing but to listen and to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you would see that effect in our life and our obedience to Allah and our good deeds and staying away from sins. You won't have that too much struggle if we have these meanings when we're reciting it every day, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of all things. لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ Then, مَنْ الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ Man here refers to العقل, right? Who? مَنْ الَّذِي Who is the one that يَشْفَعُ intercede عِنْدَهُ to him or by him إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ except by his permission. The issue of الشَّفَاعَ. الشَّفَاعَ is to intercede. الشَّفَاعَ from الشَّفَاعَ. That means one becomes two. You're alone, you're weak. So you're applying for a job or something, so you would ask for someone to help you or to talk to the owner or something. This is the shafa' that he would intercede for you. Or a letter of recommendation. This is what shafa' is. You have a letter of recommendation from someone else. This is what people, they do to one another in this life. In the hereafter, for people to enter Jannah, to be saved from hellfire and so on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He willed to honor His prophets, to honor some of the believers, in which He would allow them by His permission subhanahu wa ta'ala to intercede for those who die on La ilaha illallah, not for those who died on disbelief or ayatu billah. Only for those who died on La ilaha illallah, the prophets and the believers will be given by the permission of Allah the opportunity to intercede for them. And it would not happen except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if He's pleased with the one that would receive it. And it's after the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he's the owner of the shafa'ah, as it's mentioned in the Quran. That means what? That means a Muslim, he asks for the shafa'ah, he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it, not to ask a human being for it. And man dhalad, what's the significance of it? Maybe not much time. That is referring to someone, right? An Arab would use man dha, if that person is present, right? And if he's not present, that means they would use it still. If the person is not present, so as if you are denying if there would be anyone to dare to suggest to be an intercessor. Right? So denying this, that means nothing is left. Not just many, many. It's a question. The question that has in it to be and to make people feel terrible if they will ever think in such a way. Because the kuffar of Quraysh, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about them, that they said to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, وَيَعْبُدُونَ مَا لَا دُونَ وَلَا فَعْمَ وَيَقُولُونَ هَؤُلَاءِ شُفَعَاءُنَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ They worshipped these idols, these images that doesn't benefit them, nor it pushes harm away from them, and they would say, these are شُفَعَاءُنَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ They're not worshipping them that they are the creator of the heavens and the earth. They are making some ibadah to them, asking them, because they want them to be their intercessors to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَنَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى We do not worship them except that they will get us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called them kuffar. They believed in Allah, they want to be close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they thought that the only way is through the intercessors of these righteous people or the images of these people and so on. So مَدَّ الَّذْ يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ If a person is reciting the ayah from the beginning, would he have any dispute in this part? Of course not. He's the owner of all things. He's al hayyul qayyum and so on. Then a creation of Allah will have a say. Will have a say that he will intercede and not to intercede. Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام when he said to his family one by one on the tribe, يا صفية أنقذي نفسك من النار فإني لا أغني عنك من الله شيئا. He said, يا صفية, or the end of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, Save yourself from the hellfire. I do not avail anything for you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Fatima bint Muhammad, anqidi nafsaki min al-nar. O Fatima, the daughter of Muhammad, save yourself from the hellfire. I do not benefit you in any way from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the virtues of the Fatima radiallahu anha and Safiya and the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, first is because of their belief, because of their actions, because they were ibad to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then, because they are the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so definitely this is a virtue. But Abu Lahab, he was the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he's in hellfire when the Qur'an was recited, surah in the Qur'an about him, to show that the tithes, when it becomes benefiting, if the people are matters of an iman. So, مَنْ تَلَدْ يَشْرَعْ عَنَّهُ لَلْإِذْنِهِ, it's all related to what's before. So that would take away the ship from the heart when it comes to matters of shafa'ah. Prophet ﷺ will intercede for his ummah and the believers and so on. But we don't call upon someone that is dead. We don't call upon a creation of Allah. And you would see when we ponder over the ayat and Ayat Alkursi, that the worst evil really on the face of earth is when people associate partners with Allah. When we as Muslims today, we value things in the wrong way. That if anyone is asked what is the worst crime ever, people will have their own opinions. But in reality, the worst crime ever is to associate partners with Allah. The one that, as we heard, his names and attributes, and is the owner of all things, and he created us to worship him alone. So when people would go against this purpose of their life, what is worse than this? That's why this is the only sin that the person, if he dies on it without repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will be in hellfire forever. So, مَنْ الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عَنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ, by the permission of Allah, يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ. يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ. يَعْلَمُ means, he knows. مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ, what's between their hands and what's behind them. Physically and time-wise and in all essence in any way. What's مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ, what's in front of them, what's ahead of them, what they did in the past, what they will do in the future. What's around them, he knows everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala, his knowledge encompasses everything. What we see and what we don't see, and the whims and the desires, and no exception in the heavens and the earth, and we can talk about that also. And the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompasses everything. And the implication of that is, if that's the case, then who are we to say, why this is halal, why this is haram? So to the even to the very specifics of matters of the deen, Allah knows best. Allahu ya'lamu wa antum la ta'lamun. This is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah knows best that this is what is best for us. Not a human being that we rely on. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the one that we rely on. And the deen is the deen of Allah. And the halal is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made halal. And the haram is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made haram. And that's why this is this level of submission that a Muslim should have. يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ, الْإِحَاطَ means encompassing, right? وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ, by anything of his ilm, of his knowledge, subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ, except what he wills, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the all-knower of all things, and he allows some of his human beings to know something, like what he revealed to the messengers of Allah. This is by the will of Allah, and that's what's enough for the human beings to live as slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this life. The knowledge that we have in the deen of Islam is enough for all human beings at all times till the day of judgment to perfect the purpose of their life. What's beyond that, we don't have to have the knowledge of it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise. That's why when we talk about the qadr of Allah, it's the last pillar of an iman, and it's the least when it comes to evidences or things about it, because we don't know the essence of it. But it's enough for you if you already have the belief in Allah, we're done. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all-knower. And we just, our job is to be slaves of Allah, not to suggest things or to say why this and why that. Then we do not know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then we have deficiency in knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his names and attributes. So, يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. This is another sentence. وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ, the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Ibn Abbas of the Lu'anuma, he said, al-kursi is mawdi' al-qadr, the place of the foot. And also Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said al-ilm, the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompasses wasi'a kursiyuhu as-samawati wal-ard. And nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's spacious enough for the heavens and the earth, with all its spaciousness. وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَوَاتِ الْأَرْضِ And the kursi, compared to the arsh, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is like a ring in the desert, something that a person can never, ever comprehend. We cannot even comprehend the space of this earth compared to the Milky Way and all of these different things, right? So, وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَوَاتِ الْأَرْضِ وَلَا يَؤُودُهُ حِفْظُهُمَا وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْعَظِيمُ وَلَا يَؤُودُهُ حِفْظُهُمَا يَؤُودُهُ means لَا يُعْجِزُهُ it does not overpower Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He protects them with all of its magnificent space. He's the creator of all of these things. So He's the most high subhanahu wa ta'ala. And nothing is greater than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And all of this is under the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. كُنْ فَيَكُنْ be and become. Total submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you see the implication of this. If this is not something that will overpower Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this little tiny human being that looks like nothing compared to the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will be against the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he will be, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not able to destroy him and to do all kinds of things for him. So how then the hearts of the believers are not settled, or they think that the evil is, nobody's controlling this, or it's all by the permission of Allah. This life is a test. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لا يعجزه شيء. Nothing overpowers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even our own sense, even our own hearts. Right? When a person says, I live this life and I have sins and I have problems and so on, I don't know what to do. It's a problem when a person says this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is capable of changing your heart. If the heavens and the earth and the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and all of this, nothing overpowers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our hearts will be difficult or things of that nature. That means the problem is in ourselves that we're not turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're not asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sincerely to change our hearts. And that's the most effective tool ever for a Muslim to be steadfast, is to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our hearts steadfast on the deen of Allah. اللهم قل القلوب ثبت قلبي على دينك. The like of these dua, this is the most need that we have in this life, is to be steadfast and for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to change our hearts. Because of the time, وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَلَا يَئُودُهُ حِفْظُهُمَا وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْعَظِيمُ. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Ali. Al-Ali means the most high. The most high over His creation subhanahu wa ta'ala, over His throne. Nothing is the like of Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He is Al-Sami'u Al-Alim. And He's over His creation with His power, with His with His names and attributes, in all the meanings of Al-Ali. And the heart turns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Ali, Al-Azim. Al-Azim is the exalted, the greatest, that nothing is greater than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we heard from the creation of Allah is mentioned. It's mentioned in its perspective, although it's huge and humongous and so on, but who's the one that created it? It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So nothing is greater than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the person then, he would see that he become really foolish if he would turn to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or depend on other than Allah, or rely on to other than Allah. He would fulfill the meanings of the tawheed in all of his actions and speech, and turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and know all of these silly things of associating partners with Allah or depending on other than Allah and so on. And that's why we should recite Ayat Alkursi in the right way, and having the hearts to be reflecting upon these types of things at all times after each salah. And the more we recite it, anything other than the words of Allah or the thing that the Prophet said, if you say it many times for a week, you'll be done with it. You can't say it anymore. If you say any sentence, you know, five times a day for some time, you get bored of it. Except the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more you say it, the more you benefit from it. And the same thing with the dhikr that the Prophet taught us to say, seeking the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.